Sarah Williams, how are you?
Woo-hoo!
Absolutely, let's do it.
Yeah.
I'm in it to win it. She's Jinx and Loose Cannon and Star Guardian.
No, Jinx and Loose Cannon.
Loose Cannon, yeah, sorry. The wind is not helping me, and I'm very non-caffeinated right now. yeah, why don't you tell us, what have you worked on?
I'm Jinx, the Loose Cannon in League of Legends. I'm Neferpito in Hunter x Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Felix in ReZero. No Known Jakuzade in Kill la Kill.
I have Boone from the Cunha series. You have
Uni, yes.
Uni, sorry. Oh man, I'm so not weeb today. Alrighty, but okay. So how's your con so far? How are you feeling today?
It's very nice. It's great. And actually, now we have a nice breeze, so it's cooled down quite
absolutely.
A bit. But yeah, it's really looking great.
Of course. How did you get into voice acting?
I was an anime nerd, and I figured out I wanted to do it. And then I did all the very normal stuff of training, going to college, being a theater BA, going out to LA and just doing all the classes and meeting people and stuff. Got terribly interesting.
Yeah.
Oh no!
Yeah.
Save it, save it! I saved it.
That's great. And so how did you get exposed to anime? Like, did you do clubs and whatnot? Or?
Initially, I was like in second grade, and I came home from school one day, and I saw this show after school called Sailor Moon.
Oh, okay. I think I've heard that one before.
And I was in love with that show. I loved it so very, very much. And I sort of figured out very slowly that this was a thing that was sort of a norm.
Okay.
And I didn't understand what it was exactly, but I was like, wait, there's more cartoons like this? And I was sort of like, what is this medium I've discovered? Sort of moved on from there.
What do you like so much about Sailor Moon? What spoke to you so about that compared to other things that are American?
It was just very different than anything I'd seen when I was a little kid.
Yeah.
I initially it was just like, oh my god, this is really pretty. It's like, oh, it's so sparkly and it's all pretty and stuff and loud. But there was something different about it, and there was something different. I didn't know, I couldn't quantify it at the time because I was too young, but
absolutely.
I realized in a way, even with it, the fact that they edited it, you know, Americanized it, but there's something very, very different about the storytelling that I was seeing, as opposed to other stuff I'd seen.
When you were younger, did you kind of get exposed to like the Japanese dub in it? So and you kind of saw like, oh wow, this like what you said, like it is different, kind of Americanized.
I think that took a while longer. I was, I didn't discover the Japanese side of things until we finally got the internet for the first time.
Yeah.
Which was I was so shocked at the differences. I was like, wait, Soy Sight was a guy? What? I didn't even know how to comprehend that at the time. I was like, but yeah. I was like, but why did they? Why was he what? And sort of learning and this is like way, way back when. I like bought the whole third season fan subbed before it even ever came out legally. I was just like, I had VHS tapes of it. I was just like, there's more than what they showed on TV? Oh my god, I was so happy, I couldn't even.
Oh my god, and that's so great. So and that just kind of carried through, and then what was the first anime that kind of got like where you were like, that is what I want to do. That is like I want to the voices like this one.
I don't remember honestly. I know it was like a very slow realization, and once I was properly into it, I was fascinated by voice actors and stuff in general.
Yeah.
I forget what it was exactly that I was sort of like. It must have been some time in high school where I was sort of like, I want to do this too.
Yeah.
And I sort of was like, yeah, I think I should try this, but. Well, mostly I liked voice acting in general, but
yeah.
I hadn't conceived of it for myself until way later.
Okay. And there's a lot of work to be done right now. Like, we just had Kevin on, and we were talking about, like, audiobooks, video games, and obviously now American animation as well, or we've always had that. But there's such a broad spectrum as to what you can do with voice acting. What do you kind of go forward first to tackle? That you were paying for?
I mean, initially it was a lot of mostly just anime, but
okay.
I mean, that's because that's what I knew, but in general I was also trying to prep for everything I could. I was just more familiar with anime, but I learned over time, I sort of like adjusted to try and be good at everything because
yeah.
it is a career you want to make in the end, and
absolutely.
And the more stuff you can do, the better chance you have. Being able to do that instead of having to have a 4 to 9 to 5 to support yourself.
Absolutely. So I guess like right now, anime is such a huge, has a huge impact on our society. Where like it's gigantic. I mean, we brought back Dragon Ball Super, Sailor Moon, you know, Crystal Chronicles, and other things. How do you feel about kind of like bringing back the older stuff and either doing continuation or just revamping it? How do you feel about it?
I think it's pretty cool. As long, I sometimes don't know if I want it to be a remake or a continuation. It sort of depends. It's interesting. It is cool to see the sort of that little kid in me was sort of like, I don't want to see this again. Oh, this is amazing.
Hard.
Oh, God.
I mean, what do you prefer doing and work on? Do you want to do something that you kind of already have like an idea about and work on it? Or would you want to work on more independent stuff? So you power? How do you feel about that?
I like working.
Okay.
It doesn't really matter to me. It's just like, let me try all the things.
I like that. Have you had any of these characters that you've done, I guess on any medium, that kind of like really brought out and exhausted you? Not exhausted you, but like was kind of hard and you had to take a couple seconds to just kind of recuperate from it, emotionally or physically?
Oh, not hard. I mean, I remember doing Madoka was Sayaka Miki, and Madoka was very emotionally, not taxing, but sort of like, oh man. Even watching the show is tough again, because I'm just like, ah, they're gonna kill me emotionally, why? And then having to go back and do it all again for the movies, I'm just like, oh, goody. It's like, we're gonna do this again. It's like, on the one hand, I'm like, I love this story and I love this character, but on the other, it's like, I gotta go through that again, don't I? doing Midari from Kakegurui was a different kind of beast, because she has no chill. Hashtag Midari has no chill. She was sort of a constant sort of, oh my gosh, she never comes down. Yeah. Why?
I mean, do you ever just watch an anime or really anything that you've worked on and you watch it and you just think to yourself, that's me, I'm awesome. Do you ever have that?
It's more my own sense of, did I do okay on this? Okay, cool.
That's it? Like, you don't do any self-critique or anything like that?
No, because then I'm just sort of like, I'm going to watch the show. Sometimes I'm like, oh, there I am. Yeah, okay, that came out good. Anyway.
I completely approve. Okay, perfect. And so, does anybody have a question in the audience real quick? Alrighty, what's up? Oh, we also have a mic up there. Sorry, I forgot. I was just told. Breaking news for the main stage.
I don't know if this is a question that was already like laughing, but because I just popped in.
Bob, you look great, by the way.
Thank you so much. What would you say was like one of the hardest questions you've ever had in life? And like, what were the challenges for that game?
I wouldn't say hardest, but I did think Midari again was a challenge because again she has no chill. And again, she's much lower on my register than I've been allowed to do in terms of roles at this point. So there was some settling into her voice a tiny bit for the first few lines until I was like, yeah, I got it. I did work on this little game called, this game called Battle Chef Brigade, which is a really fun little game. It's chefs battling and they fight for recipes and not for recipes, but like ingredients and got a bejeweled aspect to it. It's really cool. And I had a character in that I had to do a Swedish accent for, and I've never done a Swedish accent professionally before, but I think it came out pretty well actually. I was really pleased with myself.
That's fine. Anybody else have a question before I keep going? All right. Eyes on church.
They'll hear you up there.
I've never gotten to just choose my own character. It'd be nice if I could. I'd just be like, that one. I was like, all right, you're in. Thank you. Man, that'd be fun if I could do that. Usually you audition, and then that depends if you get cast at all. And even then, you don't get to choose which characters you audition for sometimes. They'll sometimes give you So sometimes you didn't even know what project you're auditioning for anyway, so what would I ask for?
Yeah.
But it depends on the situation if I'm feeling brave enough to be like, hey, can I have that character too? Thanks. I mean, to read for at least. There is an occasion where I basically just automatically cast and like do this character, and I walk in and be like, so, what's the script? What am I doing? You know, you just kind of run with it because it's like they know how this works, and they know that if you're gonna throw a character at an actor, they're gonna need some explanation and a little bit of, all right, try this voice. Let's see what kind of voice you got for that. I'm like, how's this? And they're like, yeah, we like that. Do you think a little higher? Okay, yeah, we like that. Let's go. Cool.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. I mean, I guess going on that, do you prefer kind of being in the booth by yourself or doing it kind of in your own location? What do you like to do whenever you kind of channel your character?
I prefer to have a director even for auditions, but I mean, 99% of the time with auditions, you're in the booth on your own recording at home.
Yeah.
I mean, most gigs, I can't think of, most gigs I always have a director, because by then any director, every so often there has been a case where they're just like, just record it on your own and send it to us, and if we need you to redo it, we'll tell you.
Exactly.
But yeah.
I mean, but what are the differences besides having other people there of doing the group recordings? I mean, is there just a different kind of energy or anything, or?
With anime and most video games, I'm always by myself. Okay. I like group records, though, because there's definitely, you get to feed off people's energies and sort of energies, that sounds like. You get to feed off each other's energy and sort of actually, you know, act with people, and that's a cool feeling. It's a different kind of feeling that's really easy to tap into when it feels good.
Yeah, absolutely. How do you watch your anime currently? Like, are you streaming it, or like, what? How do you keep up with it?
Keep up, funny. I just stream it, but I'm always way behind. Like, stuff I watch, it tends to be stuff I bought on DVD, and I'm just like, I should watch that now, that'll be fun. Occasionally, I do stream every so often, just like, jump on the Crunchyroll or Hulu or whatever.
Absolutely. Yeah. And, I mean, what do you think about the importance of conventions like this when it comes to anime? Like, I mean, it's becoming such a, more of a norm now. A lot of people know all the stuff, we're getting major films and whatnot. How do you feel that these conventions are kind of like, what do you think that they're adding to the whole, like, little groups of people who used to just, like, love the weebs and just watch anime, and now it's just becoming mainstream?
Well, that's exactly it. It's a chance for like-minded people to get to come together and hang out with each other and talk and stuff. But again, it's like much more mainstream now, and also we have the internet, so it's easier to find online communities too.
Yeah.
But there's really nothing. There's nothing better to be like, sort of feel like. Back when, like, it's much more, there's a lot more of us now, but, I mean, back when it was a really nice feeling when you sort of were, like, one of the very few people in the school, your school, who liked this sort of thing.
Yeah.
And then you could go to something like Anime Central and just be surrounded by thousands of people like you, and you're just like, oh my gosh, I'm not alone, and I can make a friend in 5 seconds if I just go to the right people, this is great. That's a really good feeling.
Yeah, absolutely. I think like one thing about this con is it's really cool is that it's like in little Tokyo and everything, and it's like the one place that, like, especially like I'm from Texas, so like coming over here, like I want to go to, when I first moved out here, I was like, the first place I want to go to is little Tokyo. It's like exactly what I did. I think it's kind of cool, like, being here. Everybody having fun?
Yeah, definitely.
It's like going across the street, just getting awesome food and whatnot. But,
that is a plus. I've already hit Kula. Oh god, I love Kula.
Everybody get their boba runs in. All right, no tea. All right, hashtag. All right, so, oh man, what's your favorite anime trope?
Favorite anime trope? It's funny, they don't use it as well. I miss the concept of hammer space. I miss that. They don't use that much anymore. They use it a lot in Rama Half, when Akane would just get that hammer out of nowhere. And just like, hammer space! I miss that. I do love that one.
All right. Anybody else have a question at the moment? What's going on?
I have a question. When you used to see Kyoko, that you said safe things, like, don't waste food or I'll kill you, or you know, when you see like Homer and trying to get a Psycho Goosey, and then Psycho gets to throw those things away, you know, how do you feel like about the Psycho throwing things away for the sake of the waste, you know? How do you feel if the Psycho throws the apple away?
I mean, she only did that once, and I think she got the picture real quickly afterwards that she shouldn't do that in front of Kyoko. but yeah, I mean, that was more like a lesson learned. It was a symbolic thing, and yeah. But I sort of like, yeah, I sort of understand where Kyoko's coming from with that one now.
So how often do you, like, when you're working, obviously you said you could do things at home and whatnot, with Funimation being kind of set in Dallas, we have Aniplex over in Houston. Do you prefer accident flown in as well, and kind of meeting and when you do and kind of the whole shebang once you get a character, especially something that would be a little bit more ongoing?
That honestly depends. Like, I've been fortunate enough to work with Funimation, and that was awesome. Though that was a case of flying in on my own dime, but
yeah.
I wanted to because I wanted to be a part of that project. But yeah, I definitely, especially with anime, that's why I would fly in on my own dime. For anime, I want to be in the room with the director and the people.
Yeah.
I don't want to do that remotely. It's too difficult with anime. You need to have everybody there.
Absolutely.
Like, there's definitely certain things you can record anywhere. Like, I've done indie games from my home booth. I've done certain little commercials, some audiobook related stuff from my own booth. That all works all right. But stuff like the group reads for animation and definitely anime and certain video games too, it's just like, I want to be in the room with the director. I want to be there. And that's a case of, so there have been certain projects where it's just like, I will fly to you to work on this with you because I would rather be in the room with that energy with you right there as opposed to over Skype or Discord.
Yeah.
So that's when I feel like, I will make this money, I will drop the money for this because I feel like it will make a better product.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's what you want to do as an actor, and also I think that will also help you out with the relationship with the director, of course, and having them bring back. I mean, that's one thing you would not want to do in acting. Anybody else have a question? What's going on?
Hello.
Okay,
so, soldier. How did you feel when you were? How did it make you feel when, like, hey, I want to start fighting you?
I do love the chance to be in a fighting game because there's a certain sort of energy to those sorts of performances and just like I love it. Yes, I really did enjoy doing Peacock and just everything about Skullgirl. So this, yeah, it is nice when I'm your character is like a favorite one to be used.
All right. Anybody else have a question?
So what's been your funnest con experience you've ever had?
Oh.
That was really a con writing experience, though, was it? Gosh. That's always good times.
All experiences at a con are great experiences.
I'm just trying to think of one that's sort of like a really big, I mean, I remember my first year going to Otakon was like really cool because that was one of the biggest cons in the world. I was like, oh my god, I get to be here. It was a really cool experience. And I've really been enjoying like a lot of the smaller cons I've gone to. Like I just did UBCon in Buffalo, New York, I think a month and a half ago. And it was great. It was a much smaller con. It was a smaller con, a college con. But, you know, everyone was super nice and it was really nice location, and I just really enjoyed the heck out of that because there's so much. It was very chill, just sort of little experience. I like that a lot.
That's awesome. You know, since you're such a fan, way before. How did you kind of feel about the kind of lull of anime in the kind of like the mid-2000s where like before you had like five things and then it kind of got really big and popular, like all the stuff, and then kind of for a while just kind of had like a good 3 years of something that was just kind of nothing really new and nothing that kind of treaded new waters. How do you feel about like now where it feels like anything that water could have possibly gone to is now being touched? Like, how do you feel about like just that evolution from right then to where, you know, essentially the anime has become like the 14 of like
I do remember that time, but if you ask me what came out during that time, I would be hard pressed to remember just because I'd be like, well, that came out. No, that was only 2 years ago.
I feel like Full Metal Alchemist first run was like right then and there. You're just like, man, I'm only watching like a couple of things this moment. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? No? Am I crazy? You know?
Okay. Yeah, I was never that worried. I had one friend who was just like, man, anime's dying. It's dying. And like, I was like, dude, it's never gonna die. It won't. It's like, it might slow down a bit, but it's never gonna die. I didn't suppose I pictured this time where it would be like a huge, just be like, we have 20 things to watch a season. Oh, we have choices. It's like, I never expected that, but I was never too worried because I'm just like, it's a slow period. It's fine. We're fine.
What was the genre that you like to watch before, and then has it changed now?
I mean, I started out on Sailor Moon, so I've always liked magical girl stuff. it's definitely a little different now. Yeah, I mean, Monica really broke the mold, and so it's like, you like Sailor Moon. That's cute. I'm gonna break your heart now. I feel like that's a new trend. I feel like that's become a new genre of its own. The tragic magical girl show. Like, I think after Monica came out, they're like, we need to make more magical girl show where we just utterly destroy these characters. Apocalypse, anyone? Yeah! I'm not making that up. That's a manga. I've read it. It's kind of fantastic. It's messed up.
It's
oh my god. Can we make that to an anime, please?
Yes!
I'm down. Okay, so you've done American, and you've done American animation, and you've done anime. Are there any differences whatsoever? Like, with anime, it's already something that was produced. Usually with American, it's all original stuff. How do you kind of approach those different characters?
It's different styles too, for one, because anime style of acting is it's a style from. As far as I understand, and please, if you want to correct me if I'm wrong on like comments or stuff and videos that are seen of this on YouTube, as far as I understand,
don't go to the
is that section. That particular acting style is comes from Kabuki, I believe, and that's a style of basically very, very much telling everyone, this is how I feel, this is what I'm feeling right now, and you know, that's something that you sort of, it's not so extreme in anime, but there's a little bit of a... It's sort of making that shift to, because it's very heightened. It was a fun thing where I did a class for dubbing, and one of the women who was in the class had never done anime voice acting, and she didn't quite get the style. And she kept saying as she was trying to do a thing, it's like, they're like, okay, do a little more. She's like, wait, won't that be too much? And it's like, let's keep in mind this particular character she's doing, their eyes are so wide that their pupils have disappeared and their mouths are like, aah! And it's like, honey, you can do more. It's fine. You're not going to be too much for this.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, American style acting is a little more, I don't know, it can be a little more grounded depending on what you're looking at.
Yeah.
I mean, even if you look at something that's sort of quirky like Steven Universe or Star versus the Forces of Evil, there is a certain amount of groundedness to it. I mean, you still got like the SpongeBobs where it's all like, you know, wacky, kooky, and they're very much highly elevated.
Yeah.
But it is still sort of a different style to it. And also, as you said, anime, it's already done. We're coming in and matching the lip flap. And we have the, it's rather useful in some cases because you can see the scene playing out. You know what's happening. You can see what's happening. You can see how your character looks right at that moment. And you can tailor your acting to that. American animation, they rarely have anything animated.
Yeah.
They sometimes have like storyboards they can show you, some maybe an animatic. But you're sort of left to be the one that's like, I have to know in my head what's going on, what's the situation, what's my character doing. Or it also helps if with the director will help you out as well, but there's more of a sense of I have to know in my head what's going on. I have to be living in that moment because I don't have that scene already animated and ready for me to watch.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Is anybody else have any questions?
There you go, sir. Nico, Nico, me.
That's not my character.
Oh. Okay. All righty.
So my question actually is about the entertainment industry as a general concept. My question is about that. It's very, very cutthroat, very, very like competitive. So how did you gain the confidence to really like put yourself out there and make a name for yourself in the entertainment industry?
In terms of voiceover, competitive, yes, but I've never thought of it as cutthroat. It's actually, most people are pretty chill and basically sort of like willing to lend a hand and be like, lots of cases I've heard of where someone's like, it's like, do you want this role? It's like, it'd be cool to have this role, but you know who's really good at this role? You should get this so-and-so to get this role. Like, people basically like, no, wait, look at these people too. Never mind me. You should look at this guy. Competitive, yes, it is very competitive. You can be auditioning against 100 other people sometimes for one role. It's basically just, you know, it's keeping your skills up to par. It's having a realistic confidence in yourself. Like understanding that you're talented, but also understanding where you are in terms of your skill level and what you need to improve at. And improving your chances. In any way you can. It's always good to like up your odds. Like, you know, study dialects because that gives you more role options, more characters to play with. Learning breath control. Improv is supposed to be a really good thing because you never know when you need improv. Animation in particular is a place where improv is very, very utilized. So, yeah.
Awesome. Were there any lessons that you, because you studied acting in college, you said, so, right? And were there any lessons that you wish you could be kind of told you beforehand, before going out in the field?
Probably. Like so many things. Like I feel like for any kind of entertainer, like this comes up in YouTubing a lot. I think for actors, voice actors, YouTubers, I feel like colleges or like something should teach classes on professionalism. And when you're entering this field, and how to like treat your fellow peers, treat your directors and stuff, because it's a business, and there's a lot of little faux pas that you don't mean to make, and then you're like horrified that you made them later because you're like, oh god, what did I do? You know, like stuff you should. Thank you, Jeff. But like, and sometimes it's stuff that you didn't even mean to do, and you're not doing it maliciously, but you just didn't know.
Yeah.
And it would be so wonderful if there could purely be like lessons for up and coming creators and entertainers that could be like, okay, look, when you're entering the professional sphere, it is a professional sphere. These are businesses and business people that and companies that all have time schedules and things they need to make. And here's how you need to conduct yourself. Because otherwise you're gonna be wasting people's money, you're gonna be wasting people's time, you might accidentally be infuriating people and making yourself look bad. And you might not realize it because you just didn't know, and it's not like you're deliberately trying to be, but you didn't know. And I wish there could be more classes and lessons for that sort of thing. Because there's nothing, that's a horrible feeling to like think that you were doing a good job and then realizing you were doing something that you didn't even realize was upsetting people. And you're just like, oh man, now I've got a bad reputation or something, you know? So yeah.
What are some signs for you to look into? Like, because I'm guessing some people here are interested in being voice actors. I mean, it's very common here at conventions. I mean, what are some steps and some things for you people, I guess, to reflect on and notice if they are kind of becoming, not really toxic, but more of this, like, yeah, maybe not really helping them, you know, get the momentum going on their voice acting.
Don't touch the mic!
Jeff is an engineer. You, number one, in terms of voice, especially with voice acting, engineers make you sound good. You respect your engineer. Always respect your engineer.
I don't know why it muted. What happened?
Do you remember that movie with Dane Cook where he basically the woman screamed about her stupid steak not being good and they took it back to the kitchen and they all spat on it?
Waited.
I don't think you do that, Jeff, but basically, like, look, this guy is what makes your stuff sound good. It's like, yeah, these guys. Engineers have to deal with so much stuff. They have to deal with our peas popping, our lips smacking, being too, us not projecting enough. Just be kind, be respectful and kind to your engineers. They make us sound good. They're doing so much work. So yeah, number one, one rule that is coming up more and more, and I'm glad people are pointing it out, respect your engineers. They are an extremely important part of this process.
Yeah. And they talk.
Respect in general, I mean, respect your director, respect everybody you come in contact with. It's always good to be, it doesn't matter who they are. It's like say hi to the person who's helping schedule you. They're doing all this work and making sure your workflow is going good.
Yeah.
And in terms of being respectful, listen to what people are telling you. Like, I mean, I'm not saying be a doormat, because you never want to be a doormat to anyone.
Yeah.
But, you know, like, the director's going to tell you to do stuff, and you want to listen to your director. Like, take direction. And there's always a way to, like, interject your own opinion, because you don't want to just, because some, it depends on the situation. Sometimes it's a situation where it's like, you got to get work done. They have a certain way they want this to be said.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. But you can always, if you're feeling, if it feels like a good situation, you can always interject and be like, hey, do you mind if I maybe, you know, after you do what they want you to do, you can be like, hey, by the way, I have an idea how, a different way to do this line. Do you mind if I give it a go? And depending on the situation, they might be like, nope, you know what, we don't got time for that. But a lot of times, they're like, oh yeah, go ahead, just give it a show.
Yeah.
But, you know, respect them, they will generally respect you back. That's some good stuff.
Be respectful.
Be on time. If you can't be on time, be early. Because again, studio time is money, and also people are scheduled on the same day as you. And I've made this mistake too. Jeff, I was mortified. This was something I was mortified about. I was late to a session, and I was like, but I wasn't that late. It doesn't matter. I was late. Don't be late. They have, their days are scheduled. Like, you need to be there at 1 to 2, because at 2, the next actor is coming in for their session. So if you're 15 minutes late, you just messed up 50 minutes of your recording time. What if you don't get done with your time? Because they thought you were gonna get done in an hour, yeah. But now you lost 15 minutes. So be on time. Or like, I like to try and shoot for like 15-ish minutes early, like maybe 5 to 10. It's good, because also then you get to sit, then you can sort of center yourself and be like, okay, I don't have to rush, I can drink tea, and calm myself. It's good to be a little early. Not too early, but you know.
Absolutely.
Like, that 10-minute range is good. Yeah. Yeah, that's sort of the starter point.
Of course, and like, also with that, I mean, they're gonna remember you, and they're gonna be doing a lot of other projects that are not even gonna be anime-based, where you know, with animation in general. What are some creative jobs that you've actually done that you actually like really, really glad that you've done? I mean, like with commercials and stuff like that, video games as well. What are some of the ones that have been the most rewarding for you?
Just in terms of voiceover?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh, I mean, I've liked everything I've done. I mean, what have I not liked?
That's a rare quality to have.
I mean, yeah, I loved Peacock because she was my first proper game character too, and that was also a case of like great directors and sort of just having a super amount of fun. And it's always great to feel really safe and comfortable in a recording space, because that's when I feel like I do my best work.
Yeah.
And so there was that. And I was really proud of my work as Nadari. I was simultaneously like, oh my gosh, we're doing this now. But I was so very proud of what I did with that. And again, another great situation of feeling a really good director who made me feel super comfortable and just really was like there and supportive. And we were just like, yeah, we're doing this. This is sounding great. Let's keep going. Like that. Yeah.
Awesome. So what do you think is the most important thing to do for people to kind of think out of the box and creative? Because again, like you said, it's very, very competitive, especially in voice acting. What kind of venues or avenues would you suggest them to look into besides just going straight for anime?
Again, it's acting. It's in the word. So as I said, I did theater BA in college. And there's a lot of theater people who came into voice acting, which is useful for them because they've already learned how to work with their vocal cords and project on a stage.
Yeah.
Which is very helpful with their end. Improv, a lot of people have said that, and I do believe it. Improv is a good skill to pick up because it lets you fly in the moment, and you never know if you're going to walk into a session and they're suddenly going to be like, hey, that. So we understand you auditioned for this as a 40-year-old, Irish guy. But hey, you know what? Can we make him like 50 and then change him to Scottish? 2 seconds. Yeah, you never know when they're gonna change things up on you, and it's good to be able to fly on your feet and just change quickly and adapt. Yeah. I suppose I've heard. What have I heard again? Dialects are useful. Because if you can do a lot of different accents and stuff, that comes up a lot.
Yeah.
Especially in a lot of games, like all those Call of Duties, they need like multiple, they're always fighting multiple ethnicities. I talk for a living. And especially if it's like a lot of those Lord of the Ring games, they need a lot of British accents. Like a lot of those fantasy-based games, like World of Warcraft, Elder Scrolls and stuff, anything with a bunch of, like, Lord of the Rings-style fantasy settings, they're gonna have a lot of accents, and it behooves you to know a lot of those accents to help improve your chances of maybe getting in them.
Awesome. Anybody have any questions? All right.
Since I've done anything with it. Do love Boogie Pop. Gosh. I'd love to be in a Silent Hill game someday. Oh, wait.
Oh, sorry. That took me a second. Dang. Ouch.
And I got a pinball machine. And I got a pachinko version of it. The game. It's fine. We got that for Silent Hill. Thanks, Konami. I'd love to do a horror game. Like, I've done one that was a smaller indie project, and it was great. But I would like to do more horror games. That'd be a lot of fun.
You have a Fatal Frame. That's what we need.
I would like another Fatal Frame.
Yeah.
I would. Especially now that the Switch is out, I feel like that would work better.
I think so, too.
I was ordering that one on the Wii U and stuff. It's like, take away the gimmicks. Just let us do the normal stuff.
Did anything work on the Wii U, though? Anybody else have a question? Oh, yeah. All right. Front center.
Thank you. What were your favorite moments from your favorite anime?
It's like, what's your favorite anime? It's just like, wait, I've watched so many. Sailor Moon's always out there. Favorite moments. I always remember the first version of Cardcaptor Sakura in the third episode when she's going after the Shadow Card. I always remember getting watching that scene for the first time when the music starts up and she's flying after it, that adore. I love that music so much. And I was getting chills up my spine watching her summon the Windy card. I'm just like, oh my god. Oh, my little girl heart couldn't handle that. I love that so much. Ending a Wolf's Reign, too. Fuck my heart. Fuck my heart.
The feels. Anybody else have any other questions? Alrighty. Whoever goes to mic, don't run. We're not liable.
Hi there, Sarah. Before you cast us over here, have you all auditioned at any other girls? So I don't look at, and does it take a lot of work to audition other characters?
It's usually the same amount of work for any, did I audition for any other characters in ReZero? Let me think here. Goodness. No, I auditioned, ReZero, I auditioned for Grim, Ram, Puck, Felt, and what's the name of the blonde one with the twirly hair? Beatrice. So yeah, I auditioned for all of them too. Usually I audition for multiple characters on shows if I'm so fortunate. It's nice when I get to have choices. But they're all about the same amount of effort, I would say.
All right. Next question.
How's it like playing Yumi for all these years?
It's the gift that keeps on giving. And it was wonderful, because it was like I think that was my first proper JRPG role. And it was initially sort of a case of, I finished that character up in, I think, two or three sessions. I was sort of like, I wish I'd gotten more time with her. And then she came back again, and again, and again. At this point, I'm just sort of like, it's like, they have a game, Yumi's probably going to be in it, and it's really, really fun to keep coming back to that. It's nice. I like getting to spend that much time with a character. I don't often get that chance.
Yeah. Do you feel like you grow as a voice actress as your character grows as a with
Oh, yeah. It's funny to go back and listen to, like, my original Yumi, like, very first time I played Yumi, and being like, oh, wow. I was a little rough back then, wasn't I?
She's come so far. Alrighty.
What's your best video game so far, sir?
Silent Hill 2 and or probably Psychonauts or Rise Star 2. I love Rise Star. What was that one game? I was trying to remember, like, one game that I played so many times and I go back to over and over again when I get the chance.
Minecraft.
I can't remember. I think I've named them already. Yes.
Awesome. Alrighty, well, I think we only have time for a couple more questions. So I'm not going to ask you what your favorite anime is that you've done. What is your third favorite anime that you've done?
I always think it's so, it was great to be able to be involved with something like Madoka, which I, again, also like was like a massively liked itself as a show because I watched it all beforehand. I was like, oh my god, this is an amazing show. So that was really cool to be involved with. I'm really enjoying, What was it? I loved Kill la Kill. It was really great to be involved with that. And just like that show where it's just like, it's like I knew I was gonna love that show the second Gamagore came into that doorway and just loomed out and it's like, oh, it's gonna be great. So rare you find a show like within like 5 minutes of of the first episode starting that I'm just like, yeah, it's gonna be a good ride.
Yeah. Absolutely. Alrighty, any other last questions before we go?
Hello, thank you for being here. Tell us your experience with Neferpito. Haven't heard much with, you know, your different roles and whatnot. So how is that and the whole Chimera Ant arc treating you so far?
Oh, it's wonderful.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, Neferpito was a lot of fun. it's certainly one of the, I wanna say darkest character I played, but pretty darn dark. Okay. And I'm just sort of sitting there like, I'm sorry, I do what in the first episode I happened to? Really? What's my body count like in this show? Oh, okay. Jesus. But it's like, it's one of those, it's so messed up. But it's in a weird, but I sort of enjoy how messed up it can get. Because then I'm just like, well, I get to tap into some dark stuff, and that's fun as an actor.
One last question? Anyone? Bueller? Alrighty, when's your signing? Do you have any information for the signing?
I believe that's in about an hour, 4 o'clock. And I think that's just in the lobby area, I believe.
Alrighty. 4 o'clock for signings, you guys. Come by. Is there anything else that's coming up that you can talk about?
NDA.
Yep.
We just really, the trailer for this project I'm in called Diesel Dust is just released on YouTube. Like a CG animated, sort of western-y style cartoon. I think it looks really awesome. I'm really excited to be a part of it. It looks cute. So, yeah, maybe check that out. It's cute.
Absolutely. All right, thank you guys so much for coming out today, Sarah Williams. We'll be coming at 4 o'clock in the lobby. Thank you so much. And again, I am Tyler from the Grand Geek Gathering. The Grand Geek Gathering, the podcasts. We have articles and celebration of geekdom and panels. We have a panel at 6:45 downstairs in the Garden Room, Unnecessary Debates in Geek Culture. We have Kayla Malari from the Core Dance Crew. We have Minx from Midnight Shinigami. And we also have Rocky from Anime for Humanity, awesome charity. And it's going to be a lot of fun. And of course, Marcella Samuel, a stand-up comedian who's very close with this convention as well. Thank you guys so much. Again, thank you so much, sir. You have a great rest of your con, you guys. Thank you so much. Running Expo 2019. And go buy table 6 where the art is going to be for my panel, Unnecessary Debate, to get a little bit of tea.